Thank you all for coming. My name is Brian Fishman. I'm a research fellow here at the New America Foundation. Really appreciate you taking the time out, both those in the room and also watching online, for this event to talk about one of the more important issues of the day, domestically at least, which is the use of infiltration and surveillance techniques to counter domestic terrorism. What we're going to look at today, I hope that we focus on, is the question not that gets looked at most often, which is the issue of whether these techniques are moral and legal, but I really want to explore, and I hope you'll ask questions related to the issue of when should they be used from a practical standpoint? Do they work, and how well do they work? And let's dive down into that a little bit. So one of the reasons, and probably the most important reason that we're having this discussion, is the series of Associated Press articles about the NYPD's program to monitor and surveil suspected terrorists and the communities in which they reside in and around New York City. Two of the Pulitzer Prize-winning reporters that wrote that series of reports are here with us today, Matt Apuzzo and Adam Goldman. Their two colleagues, Eileen Sullivan and Chris Hawley, are not here. They put the prize in your hand yesterday.
Yes.
So congratulations. And then we also have John Berger, who's just completed what I think is a really interesting and comprehensive report looking at an FBI investigation of the Patriot Movement in the early 1990s. You can find hard copies outside. It's also online at the New America Foundation website. And what this does is it really sort of details the process that the FBI went through as it was trying to understand a quite radical milieu in which it had the sense that very bad things were happening but couldn't quite put its finger on it. And so you get this process of mission creep that is quite interesting. To frame this a little bit, I want to just throw out some statistics from a New America Foundation study that was done by my colleague Peter Bergen, former colleague Andrew Leibovich, and then Jennifer Rowland, who's sitting out at the table out there, a project that they did with the Maxwell School up at Syracuse, looking at homegrown terrorism. And what they did is they looked at 192 cases of jihadist-related homegrown terrorism since 9/11, and 118 cases of sort of left and right-wing terrorism from after 9/11. What they found is that in terms of the casualties that this created, it's relatively a small problem. 30 people were killed, 17 of those related to jihadist terrorism, 13 related to sort of left and right extremists. That relates to 73 Americans killed in hate crimes during that time period and 15,000 Americans murdered every year. So we should keep this problem in context. Now, of course, those numbers would have gone way up if Umar Farouk Abdulmutallab had been able to successfully detonate the underwear bomb in the Northwest Airlines flight over Detroit. So there are some very near misses in that keep those numbers down. But one of the things, and perhaps the most relevant for our conversation here today, is that 40% of those jihadist plots were involved an FBI informant or an undercover operative within those plots. And one of the misconceptions that I'd like to point out, and the reason why we have this panel structured as it is that while 40% of the jihadist plots perhaps were stopped or were law enforcement used those kinds of techniques to deal with them, 50% of the right-wing and left-wing plots had an informant or an FBI undercover. This is not just, contrary to popular belief, at least on the national level, this is not just an issue that impacts the American Muslim community. And I think that's important, and we should look at that sort of very closely. So with no further ado, I'm going to try to stay out of the way for this conversation as much as possible. Goldman's mocking me over there. I'm going to turn this over to Matt and to Adam. They're going to talk for 20 minutes or so. Then we'll go to John Berger, who will provide some historical perspective. And then we'll turn it over to Q&A. When we get to the Q&A part of this conversation, I hope you'll speak up. Please wait for the microphone and announce your name and affiliation when we do that. So with no further ado, Matt, Adam?
Yeah, so I'll just talk for a few minutes just about what the NYPD is doing so we have a little sort of factual background. And then Adam will talk a little bit about what's been accomplished, what's been missed. So after 9/11, as I am sure most people here know, Ray Kelly became the new police commissioner in New York, and one of the first things he did was sort of reinvigorate the intelligence division. The intelligence division had become the, kind of this backwater, you know, glorified chauffeur service for diplomats visiting New York. But in its heyday, you know, the intelligence division had, you know, red squads in the sort of the hunt for communists. They were infiltrating student groups, civil rights leaders. You know, they were videotaping protesters. They had undercovers in all of the, you know, sort of the activist groups, the unions, anybody who was, you know, potential troublemaker. That, after a class action lawsuit, the intelligence division was basically lopped off at the knees and became this, you know, backwater. But Ray Kelly decides they need an intelligence division again, and looking for somebody to run it. He hires Dave Cohen, who's former deputy director of operations at the CIA, basically the nation's top spy. So he arrives and realizes he needs help, and so he calls down to Langley and gets George Tenet on the phone and says, you know, what New York needs is we need somebody who's still in the CIA but working with the NYPD. So so George Tenet sends up a man named Larry Sanchez, and Larry is working for the CIA. He's on CIA payroll. He has an office at the CIA station in New York, but he also has an office at the NYPD, and his job is to basically be Cohen's personal liaison to the CIA, and he helps to create some of the programs that have become hallmarks of the NYPD over the past decade. One of the first things they did was create what is known as the Demographics Unit. The Demographics Unit basically carved up the city into various zones and dispatched teams of plainclothes officers, typically Arab or South Asian officers in their 20s. They would go out to restaurants, delis, hookah bars, cafes, clubs, basically wherever Muslims would hang out. And their job was to chat up the owner, engage his sentiment. What does he think of America? So take a look around. Are people watching Al Jazeera? How are they reacting to Al Jazeera? What are they talking about? Sit in the booth, maybe listen in on a couple of conversations in the next, you know, at the next table. Try to figure out, like, what do people here think? And every day they're writing up these daily progress reports. I mean, we've seen the reports, and it'll say, you know, so and so, you know, this restaurant is owned by, you know, so-and-so. He appears to be a devout Muslim. He's from Pakistan. You know, they'll collect phone numbers off the bulletin boards of people who are renting rooms. So all those phone numbers will go into the database. Oh, who's renting a room in Muslim neighborhoods? So you end up with these big reports, you know, reports on Moroccan neighborhoods, Egyptians, Syrians, Lebanese, Albanians. And the idea is if there's ever a credible threat of an Albanian terrorist in New York, they can just go grab the Albanian report, and they know where they're going to work, eat, shop, pray, where they're going to get their hair cut. I mean, how many Pakistanis are cab drivers and what their medallion numbers are. So there's the demographics unit, and then they also have, you know, this long roster of informants, sort of colloquially known as mosque crawlers. This is a program that was basically cribbed from the CIA, and while the CIA quickly determined that it was a waste of time, the NYPD has really embraced it. Basically, it takes you take paid informants and you have them just sort of cycle through the mosques of New York City and just kind of be the eyes and ears of the NYPD inside the mosque, and they're giving daily reports to their handlers about what they're hearing. I mean, some of the reports we've seen include, you know, very innocuous stuff. Talking about we should plan a protest, we should have a letter writing campaign against, you know, the Prophet cartoons, and, you know, we should talk to our local politicians, and all that gets, you know, sort of the idea of who's active in the community. These guys get put in databases. Who's speaking up? Who, you know, even if you speak up and say peacefully, you know, you're going to go into a police file. They also had a cool program that we never heard of before. If you get your name changed in the city of New York, every couple weeks the court system sends the database of everybody who changes their name in the city of New York to the NYPD. And their analysts go through and they look for people who have sort of, for lack of a better way to say it, Muslim-sounding names going to American-sounding names, you know, whatever an American-sounding name is, right? So Muhammad Amir to John Smith, you get flagged and you're going to go into a file. And then if you're John Smith and you're going to Muhammad Amir, you're going in a file. And then what they do is they'll run background checks against you and they'll see, you know, and because they have access to all these federal databases, you know, they have access to Treasury Department records so they can look at your foreign travel. They can, they'll check and see if you've ever applied for a city job, if you've passed any background checks. You know, they'll obviously do open source, you know, accurate auto track reporting. And all of this is collected and maintained in police databases. The idea being, well, that, you know, there are people like Carlos Bledsoe who changed his name, you know, converted to Islam, changed his name and shot up Little Rock, Arkansas recruiting station. And people like David Headley, who changed their name to sound very American so that they could travel and go unnoticed. So that kind of became the hallmark of the NYPD is sort of when one or two things happen, we go and look there to make sure it's not a, maybe you should make sure that's not a trend, or we assume it is a trend. So they spent a lot of time, you know, finding out where people work out because, you know, the 9/11 hijackers worked out at gyms. So like where, if you're a Moroccan, where would you, what gym would you go to? They determined you would probably go to the Y. They went and took pictures of the Y and went in and talked to the guys who run the Y and, you know. You know, so those are the programs and they, the net was just so wide, that it that lots of people, I mean, you know, that, yeah, lots and lots of innocent people are put into these databases, including many of the same Muslim community leaders who, sort of stand shoulder to shoulder with the NYPD and Mayor Bloomberg and sort of have decried terrorism. So, I mean, literally some of the leading imams who, you know, when there's a foiled plot or, you know, one of these things, you know, these imams come forward and they stand behind Bloomberg when Bloomberg says, you know, we won't accept this in our city and we're going to fight this. These imams are there. They have dinner or breakfast with Bloomberg. Meanwhile, they're also being spied on by the NYPD. They have informants directly attached to them. They have an undercover officer in their mosque. And, you know, the idea is sort of a total penetration of, you know, the communities where the NYPD has decided a terrorist is likely to be. I mean, they've mapped every mosque, you know, within hundreds of miles of New York. And they also have, it's gotten steadily to be not just terrorism. You know, we've seen documents that showed that they went to New Orleans to attend a people summit, which is basically a gathering of community organizers and liberal advocacy groups getting together to talk about, you know, the problems with free trade agreements. And they infiltrated that meeting. They sent an undercover to New Orleans to write up reports about all these liberal groups who were there and what were they talking about and who was their leaders. And again, they say this is open source. A lot of this is open source stuff, you know, so they're totally allowed to do it and they're totally allowed to collect it. But some of it is also, you know, they have cameras all across the city and, you know, they have cameras that are trained on mosques. They have undercover cars that sit outside mosques and videotape people coming in and out and pull the license plates of everybody who's going to mosques. And so they know who's going to what mosque. And then the last thing I want to say is the fascinating thing about all this is, you know, so the Department of Homeland Security has given something like $1.6 billion to the NYPD since 9/11. They really don't make any bones about the fact that they don't know where this money goes. Like, they don't know what it's used for. The city council approves the NYPD's budget, which is roughly $4 billion every year, and has never once held a hearing on what's the intelligence division doing. There was once a hearing in Congress, sort of an informational hearing in front of Senate Homeland, and Larry Sanchez testified about all the great work they were doing. And he made a comment and he said, you know, one of the things that's been critical to what we do here at the NYPD is we view activities that are historically protected by the First and Fourth Amendment as, we now view them as potential precursors to terrorism. And nobody on Capitol Hill said, huh, tell me more about that. I mean, nobody wants to know. The White House has sent millions of dollars directly from its drug czar budget to under a program called HIDA, High Intensity Drug Trafficking Area. They have this program that's used to combat drug trafficking. And that money, since 9/11, is being used to fund the cars that do the undercover surveillance in Muslim neighborhoods, the computers that store all this information, you know, there's the office space where this is being run out of. And you ask the White House, you know, hey, so how does this fit? Tell me, is this what you mean when you talk about, you know, sort of the police department being on, we want police departments to be on the cutting edge of sort of our outreach efforts to the Muslim community. Should this be a model? And they say, well, look, we don't decide where the money goes or what it's used for. We're just a policy office, so we don't get a say. So we don't feel like we should have to weigh in on whether we agree or disagree with what this is being used for. So nobody really has any oversight of where this money's going or any visibility into it. All of the documents we got would be exempt from, you know, open records requests. Lawmakers hadn't seen it. And the last thing I guess I would say is, if this may be, this really well may be the best way to fight terrorism in American cities. And if it is, then why would we want to have that why would we want to have programs like this only in New York? I mean, New York is the biggest target, but certainly not the only target. Why wouldn't we want a demographics unit in every city? I mean, why wouldn't we want these cameras all in every city? And if it is not the best way, I mean, if it turns out, you know what, this isn't the best way to fight terrorism, then why would we want New York City, our main target, to be using anything other than the best tactics to fight terrorism? So the only way you can sort of have that discussion is by actually acknowledging what it is that is happening there and figuring out, is it the best, smartest way to do counterterrorism, you know, 12 years after 9/11? So that's kind of what, you know, the kind of discussions we've hoped that the series we've written would get people talking about.
Well, one of the things that we were able to do after we were provided literally hundreds of secret NYPD documents is examine their programs and where they were, who they were spying on, whether it was the Muslim student, the MSAs, what mosque they're in. And I'll just quote from you from one of the stories we wrote. When the NYPD's effectiveness is questioned, the department's most ardent supporters frequently point to a long list of terrorist plots said to have targeted New York since 9/11. The list often is described as plots thwarted by the NYPD. It's usually 13 or 14. That's the NYPD narrative. In reality, however, the NYPD played little or no role in preventing many of those attacks. Some, like a cyanide plot against the subway system, were discovered among evidence obtained overseas but were never set in motion. Others, like the 2006 plot to blow up U.S. bound airliners using liquid explosives, were thwarted by U.S. authorities and the plans never got off the ground. More recently, you might have heard there was a big trial in New York City. A man by the name of Adis Madunjanin was convicted of terrorism charges, and he'll probably go to jail for the rest of his life. Well, Adis was good friends with a guy by the name of Najib Bulazazi and another guy by the name of Zorain, and they were good buddies. They all lived in this Queens neighborhood, and these were the people that programs were designed to catch. And these were the stereotypes. But the thing about it is they missed them completely. They'd infiltrated Madunjanin's student organization, Queens College, missed them. They were in their mosque. They missed all three of them. They all attended the same mosque. They missed all three of them. So it raises questions about, well, if they were designed to catch these people, then how did they miss them? Another good example is Bryant Neal Vinnis. And Bryant Neal Vinnis is one of the more extraordinary figures in counterterrorism. He was from Long Island. He got radicalized out there. And through perseverance, he made his way to Pakistan and met with al-Qaeda's leadership. not one or two, but he met with Rahman, he met with all the top guys, and he was helping them with a plot to blow up the Long Island Railroad. Once again, he was not on the NYPD's radar. And Zazi, and the other interesting thing about the Zazi plot is, you know, the NYPD said, we can't rely on the federal government anymore, so we have to recreate this intelligence division. But the most serious plots that this country has faced since 9/11 were, in fact, thwarted by U.S. intelligence. They were thwarted by NSA. They were thwarted by the CIA, and they were thwarted by the FBI. Another interesting example is Shahzad, the Times Square bomber. For all the cameras we have in Times Square, and for all the technology that's touted, we missed Shahzad. Shahzad came this close from blowing up his car. So we wrote a story, and we were wondering, when we examine these successes, and there's never been a public reckoning for whether this in fact works. You know, when we have 9/11, oh my God, we got the 9/11 Commission report. There's a total examination. I mean, everybody's perfectly willing to tear apart the FBI or CIA and put them on display. Or, you know, what happened with the underwear bomber in 2009? There were hearings on that. How did that happen? We have to fix that. But we're not asking those same questions about the NYPD. Why did the NYPD miss Zazi? And once again, it goes back to the programs and the effectiveness. And that's one of the things we tried to examine in our reporting. Do these programs actually work? And as we were doing the series, we were asking the questions, and there was a lot of pushback about the mere fact of asking these questions. And you know, Matt and I believe that these were worthy questions to be answered. So,
okay, thanks, John. Why don't you tell us a little bit about the PatCon investigation?
Sure. So, you know, the PatCon investigation is fundamentally different from the NYPD program in some ways. It targeted the Patriot community, which is a loose coalition that was very active in the 90s and still exists today, of anti-government extremists of various stripes, a lot of overlap with organized racism. And the problem with, you know, the movement and where it does start to resemble what happened with the NYPD is that these guys were, you know, pressing up against the First and Fourth Amendments in very similar ways. The FBI decided that they wanted to prioritize investigating this movement after the rise of a criminal gang called The Order, which was hitting banks in armored cars and using the proceeds to fund white supremacists. Bunch of money. They stole $4 million, and a vast majority of that money was never recovered. And the FBI was concerned that this money was being used to fund extremism, so they took on a number of initiatives to try and tackle this movement. They used a variety of paid informants and unpaid informants, and then in 1991, they launched an undercover operation called PatCon, in which three FBI agents posed as a white supremacist group that they'd completely invented called the Veterans Aryan Movement. And it was initially deployed against a group in Texas, and then that kind of went nowhere, and so they shifted their focus to an Alabama group. They found some evidence of criminal activity there, but they didn't do anything about it, and then they shifted to a group in Tennessee. All the while, you know, collecting intelligence, basically, and the agents, some of the agents who worked on this case told me that this was designed to create intelligence on the Patriot community. The problem with that is that the FBI's guidelines for how they do this kind of Group 1 well-funded undercover operation requires them to have a specific crime that they're investigating, a suspected crime or an imminent crime. When this started, they used as a pretext the fact that some of these guys in Texas had been making threats about FBI agents who were investigating them. These threats never went anywhere. They were just talk, as far as anybody could really tell. But they continued to be the pretext for this investigation as it sort of spread out into an interstate investigation of multiple groups. Basically, you know, after a bit more than 2 years of full-time undercover penetration of this movement, they came out of this with no arrests. One person and some members of his group in Alabama went to jail for the theft of military equipment, but the undercover investigation never came into play in that. The Army's Criminal Investigative Division and another FBI informant who wasn't involved in this program provided all of that information. They spent upwards of $100,000 carrying out this investigation. They crossed state lines on numerous occasions. They recorded information that even FBI headquarters kind of pushed back on them and said, you know, this is really First Amendment stuff. You know, you have to be careful of this. They go to these rallies that these guys would hold, and, you know, there's a lot of anti-government rhetoric and a lot of political and extreme religious rhetoric and racist rhetoric and a lot of stuff that's very unpleasant but is not illegal. And finally, when the investigation was shut down, it was shut down with prejudice. You know, the investigating agents were ordered to stand down and not to conduct any further investigation of the group. It was a strongly worded rebuke that indicated that they had gone too far with this. The thing about this is a case study that really goes into a lot of detail about this one operation, because I think that there's a lot of interesting dilemmas that you can see play out in this thing. These guys, unlike what the NYPD is doing, these guys were following leads. You know, it wasn't just a sort of an abstract interest in the movement, although they had that and they used it for that. But they were getting leads. They were hearing things that were really alarming, that they were going to blow up a federal building, we're going to do this, we're going to do that. And there were actual crimes being committed, theft of military property and its resale, and some explosives and firearms type violations. But the fact is that the investigation, you know, just produced a tremendous amount of data, produced a tremendous amount of activity, and spent a pretty good amount of money, and didn't catch who it needed to catch. In the middle of all this activity, these groups getting together and conspiring and selling weapons and trading stuff off, literally through the middle of the investigation, Timothy McVeigh walks in 1993 and goes unnoticed. And not only does McVeigh himself completely escape scrutiny during this period, but the people he was associated with who were involved in these groups, there were files on some of the guys that McVeigh was hanging out with and on the groups that they belonged to, including a guy named Andreas Strassmeier and a guy named Roger Moore. And both of these guys were identified as potential suspects in the investigation of the Oklahoma City bombing after the fact. As far as anyone can tell, none of this information, all this intelligence that was gathered in the course of this undercover operation, none of it came into play. These guys had organizational links that were significant to McVeigh's actions, and, you know, nobody pulled out these files and said, hey, look, you know, because that's, if you're going to do this collection, the point of it is that you're going to have that information when you need it. You know, that you're going to understand these networks better and you're going to understand the connections that these people have. And nobody pulled out, nobody made the connection that Strassmeier had been involved with this group in Texas, and nobody made the connection that Roger Moore had been in this group in Alabama. So, you know, there's multiple questions about how the utility of this investigation, and, you know, were we better off that this investigation took place, or are we better off if it didn't? And that's complicated by the fact that in the Patriot movement, one of their big themes is really that the government is out to get them. And they knew some of these guys were informants. They knew some of these guys were undercover agents, or some of them at least claimed after the fact that they knew it, whether they knew it at the time. Some cases they did, in some cases they didn't. They base a lot of their strategy around fear of infiltration. A lot of their enmity for the government has to do with infiltration and pressure points that were put on them related to infiltration. Ruby Ridge, the killings of Ruby Ridge, which inflamed the Patriot movement, ultimately started because the ATF was trying to coerce Randy Weaver, a very small-time white supremacist, into being an informant. When he refused, they put pressure on him. The pressure escalated, and it ended up, you know, his 14-year-old son and his wife were killed in a siege that ultimately boiled down to his refusal to be an informant. And there are other examples. I mean, basically, you know, the question that I had in reading this is just, you know, how much enmity and mistrust does this create when you look at it in the whole? as opposed to when you go through, you know, and one reason Brian asked me for about 5,000 words on this, I gave him 15,000. Because when you go through decision by decision and, you know, you look at each individual decision and you say, you know, of course they had to investigate this. Of course they should have kept going with this. But then when you look at it as a whole and you look at, you know, how these guys were inflamed by some of these activities, you know, you have to look at it both on the macro and the micro. And the question is really, you know, are you doing more harm than good? And I'll just leave it at that.
So I'm gonna ask a couple of questions and then we'll turn it over to the audience. I want to be a little bit of a naysayer, right, to you guys. Like, I think that the argument that I think we would get from NYPD is that a lot of the time they were following leads, right? And so I'm wondering from Matt and Adam, you guys were able to get access to a lot of documentation. But one of the lessons that I take from some of the instances where documents have been released, whether it's through WikiLeaks or through sort of authorized leaks in one way or another, is that we're only seeing a partial bit, right? And sometimes because we're seeing something that was supposed to be secret and it is brought out into the open, we think we're seeing everything. What do you guys think that you weren't able to see? And it seems to me that that's likely the things that would have been more highly classified would have been around specific leads, around specific individuals, those kinds of things that might have shown a different light on this.
I'll take a first crack and then kick it to Adam. But so first of all, none of this stuff's classified. Let's be clear. The NYPD does not have classification authority.
Sure.
They can stamp the word secret on it. That doesn't actually make it secret. So the other part is that, you know, what is a lead, right? So, I mean, I don't think the NYPD is being disingenuous, or I don't think they're lying when they're saying we're following a lead. You know, the a lead in some of these documents is somebody, you know, don't take my word for it. I mean, you can go on ap.org/NYPD and read these documents yourself. I mean, it says that a lead, something you want to flag, is a business where people from the community could gather and thus could be a breeding ground for, you know, could be a place where co-conspirators could meet, right? I mean, one of the leads in the Albanian documents, and again, this wasn't like a selective page. This is, we have the entire Albanian report. It says, you know, oh, hey, we made note of this potential hotspot. It's a park in an Albanian neighborhood where old Albanian men come to play chess. And that was put in the report because that could be some Albanian terrorists could get together and play chess in the park. So, I mean, a lead is not, at the NYPD, a lead is not what a lead is at the FBI. The FBI's guidelines are, I mean, what's the DIOG? Is it, you know, 800 pages now or something? I mean, the NYPD's guidelines are like 11 pages. So a lead is not, at the NYPD, is not what a lead is at the FBI. And while the FBI is prohibited from, as you said, you know, collecting purely First Amendment activity that's not connected to any criminal information, and the NYPD does not face that prohibition because they're not a federal agency. So they collected lots of stuff that is not collected to terrorism, but is purely First Amendment. So I mean, I guess I would just say that, you know, I think they are following leads. I think they just have a very different definition of what a lead is, and a lead to them is anywhere where a terrorist might be. And they will say we have to do that because this is New York and we were attacked and we haven't forgotten, even though the rest of the country has.
Well, I'll just add, you know, the bar was lowered in 2003 when Dave Cohen became, ironically, DCI of the NYPD. Dave wrote an affidavit to a federal judge in this class action lawsuit that the lead plaintiff was Barbara Hanchu. It's known as the Hanchu Agreement. And he went to the judge and said, look, we've got to be able to stop attacks before they happen, so we have to be able to do preventative counterterrorism work. So the judge said, okay, well, we're going to lower the bar from probable cause to reasonable suspicion. Reasonable suspicion is pretty vague. It's sort of like they're stop and frisk. They, you know, they stop and frisk people when there are furtive movements. You know, that that could essentially be anything. From the majority of documents that we did have, Matt and I went to great lengths to talk to people, and I've said this publicly before. You know, we talked to people within the NYPD. The FBI didn't know this was going on. They didn't know there was a demographics unit. They didn't know they were rakers. Ironically, this sort of came out of from the U.S. intelligence community, and they most of the time they would tell us that we weren't following leads. We were following Muslims. And but then again, we are sitting on other files. I mean, there's lots of stuff we haven't published, and it's clear from those files that they were investigating people who were making inflammatory comments. Osama bin Laden's a great guy. I mean, what's happening in Afghanistan is wrong, and that's a red flag. And I think just like the FBI, they would do an assessment and see if there's anything real there. The problem looking at these files is even after the Joint Terrorism Task Force, which is the lead body for investigating terrorism in the United States, the JTTF would say, yeah, we looked at this guy, we did our 180-day assessment, there's nothing here. Well, for the NYPD, that didn't matter. They continue to investigate them. They're looking for a threat that perhaps isn't there.
Right, which is, I mean, they're right to do.
Yeah, and they can do that.
I think that is one of the questions of post 9/11 America. Like, what is a lead? I mean, the NYPD's spokesman says they have to go anywhere where there's a possibility of criminal activity. I mean, that can be
this rule.
That's everywhere, right? And what is a red flag? I mean, I am sure that there have been discussions in this room where people have talked about the problems with drone strikes in Pakistan. I'm sure there are people who've been in this room who have said, that they're opposed to Israeli policies in Gaza, the West Bank. Those kinds of things, if said in a mosque, almost certainly end you up in an intelligence file at the NYPD. And is that a red flag? I don't know. Is that where we're at now?
John, what did the leads look like in the PatCon case? I mean, what constituted a lead at that point?
Well, the PatCon case started with a walk-in informant saying that he heard that the civilian material assistance group, which had been involved in Iran-Contra and became a white supremacy-oriented group after that fizzled out, was planning to do hit a nuclear power plant. So, this is a serious threat. They were talking about doing a raid on a nuclear power plant where they thought that there was a gigantic armory of weapons, and then it never went anywhere. And it sat, and they watched these guys, and they expanded. What they were watching. The threat that actually started the PatCon undercover investigation proper was that these guys were sitting around talking about killing a couple FBI agents, and then it came out that they had driven by the guy's house and kind of collected a little bit of information on him. But almost immediately what happened was they put before they did the PatCon undercover, they just put a regular Group 2 undercover, which is just a more informal kind of arrangement, had somebody pose as a hitman and go up and make himself available to kill these guys. Mm-hmm. And they're like, no, we're going to do this after the revolution. Mm-hmm. And that was basically it. But the threat stayed as the justification for this thing for a long time, because what they saw was an opening. Unlike, with the NYPD has a broad mandate to collect and prevent, and this was prior to 9/11 and the shift to prevention, they needed a hook. But once they had that hook, they ran it right into the ground.
One of the lessons of the post 9/11 world and one of the lessons from the 9/11 Commission report was we failed to connect the dots. We weren't working across bureaucratic boundaries. We need to do that better. And I'm sure that the concept of putting Dave Cohen at NYPD and then Larry Sanchez was an attempt to do that. We know that we live in a world where the political boundaries don't mean as much as they used to. We talk about that all the time for various reasons, both international travel, the internet, et cetera. are some of our notions of what is, of what law enforcement and intelligence can do domestically outdated? I mean, given that world.
Who are you asking?
I'm asking you and Adam.
I mean, I don't know. I don't know that they're outdated. I mean, the FBI, I mean, after 9/11, we modernized everything, right? I mean, the FBI has all these new rules.
Except the FBI's computer system.
Except the FBI's computer system, right. The FBI, right, so the FBI has all these rules. It's not clear, I mean, it's never been discussed what the NYPD was doing. So, I mean, I don't know that it's outdated. And maybe it's because the reason we don't know it's outdated is because we're 12 years after 9/11 and we're just now talking about what's been going on in the city where 9/11 happened for the first time and having a real discussion about what's been going on.
Well, you know, interesting aside, the model that the NYPD built this thing on was the Israeli model. And
the demographics unit.
The demographics unit. Mm-hmm. And they were treating Brooklyn and Queens like these were the West Bank, you know, Judea and Samaria, whatever you want to call it. But the problem with that model is we don't have settlements. These aren't occupied territories. We don't have a wall separating Queens from Manhattan. So,
and we don't have a national religion.
So
I mean, not forget that either. I mean, we don't have a national religion.
But at the same time, it's really important for the NYPD to understand the population in New York City, whether it's to understand communities or understand a threat after an attack, who to communicate with, et cetera, right? Isn't that important?
Is it more important for people in New York, for the NYPD to understand the community in New York than it is for the Detroit Police Department to understand it in Detroit? Because if it is, and this is the best way to do it, why wouldn't we want this in Detroit?
They've said.
I mean, let's put this in Detroit.
The LAPD, Chicago PD, Newark, in Michigan too, they don't do this there.
And they say they don't want to do it. Right. And
I
so
mean, there's an enormous Persian community in Los Angeles. Now, granted, they're a little, they're very affluent, and most escaped, you know, most left Iran because they were anti-regime. But there might be a few people in there that like the regime here today. So are we supposed to root through all the Persians to find that handful? And, you know, the other thing that gets lost in this, the people coming here, you know, we describe them as Muslims, but they're Americans. And they came here for the same reason, you know, my grandfather, you know, escaped from Poland, you know, and the anti-Semitism there. And they are Americans. And, you know, the vast majority of them did leave these countries because they wanted to enjoy what America was giving them. So,
And to your point, Brian, I mean, look, I keep coming back to this. If this is the right way to do it, and we're not counterterrorism experts, I mean, we're reporters. If this is the right way to do it, then, I mean, why isn't there more of a groundswell on Capitol Hill to say other police departments should be doing this? Why isn't, you know, why aren't the congressmen, you know, from Michigan saying, Detroit, this is your dereliction of duty here.
Right.
Why are you not doing this? Why is we have to look to New York?
CIA, the CIA had a clandestine operative, not Larry, but after Larry, in the NYPD, they eventually yanked him out. But, you know, that was the only relationship of its kind in the country, You know,
Why wouldn't we want that in L.A.?
There was a millennium, there was the planned millennium attack there. There was the attack on the airport.
Abdul Muttalib was coming to Chicago.
Why wouldn't we want the CIA in all of our departments making, you know, using these cutting edge programs that they've crafted to decimate al-Qaeda? Why wouldn't we want all these programs in the, you know, police departments across the country?
John,
I want to address the assumption that's built into your question,
sure,
which is that 9/11 was a failure of collection.
Sure.
It was not a failure of collection. It was a failure to synthesize the information that was collected. What you can see, I think, the outlines of in this PACON report is that Oklahoma City was not a failure of collection. Mm-hmm. It was a failure to use the information that was collected properly. Mm-hmm. The reason that is usually cited, especially in 9/11, but also in Oklahoma City, for failing to make those connections is that there was too much information. So if you're drinking from the fire hose, as it's often referred to, is the solution, and you can't drink from the fire hose, and you know, you're having a problem, you know, should you put three more fire hoses pointed at you is not the solution to that problem. Right. You know, it was never a failure of a collection. It was a failure to understand how to use the intelligence that was being collected.
Right. I mean, and that's a great point. One of the things, though, that has changed after 9/11 is that the political pressure on the intelligence community, law enforcement, has changed fundamentally. I mean, polls in New York show that these programs are relatively popular. And I think that the pressure on the people that work in these programs is immense, right? Because precisely for the reasons that we talk about, I mean, you know, when you look at the underwear bomb plot from a couple of years ago, the recriminations pointing at the IC were, you know, should these people be criminally charged? Did they fail fundamentally in their responsibility to keep the United States safe? That pressure is immense, and I think that the people working on these things every day feel that the weight of that responsibility. How do you frame a program that doesn't do this kind of stuff if there is the perception that it's going to work? How can NYPD at this point, and if they decided that this doesn't work, could they change, considering our political environment, right? The way that we think about this. We want our law enforcement going out there, and we know in both the case in New York and in the PatCon case that there was a there, right? There are plots out there in this milieu. There was Timothy McVeigh. It wasn't like they were looking somewhere crazy.
So right? here's the logical. So Dave Cohen gave a deposition in one of the many lawsuits in which he said, they asked him, they said, well, this lawsuit was over random searches of your bag and your person when you get on the subway. And Dave Cohen said, look, we have to do that because this is a deterrent for terrorism. Mm-hmm. And the lawyer said, well, how do you know? He said, well, I've been doing this for 25 years. He said, you've been searching people for 25 years? No, but I've been in counterterrorism for 25 years. But yeah, but how do you know this works? And he says, well, what do you mean, how do I know? I'm an expert. And he said, well, right, but how do you know that this works? And he said, well, it's simple. They haven't attacked us again. Right. So.
Wait, I want to add to that because I have the exact quote. He said, quote, I never bothered to look.
If it doesn't exist, it doesn't exist.
Is there a methodology to find out if these things work? I've never bothered to look, but it doesn't exist as far as I know. And then the proof was they haven't attacked us again. So, I mean, you're right. There's a huge political pressure. There's also a huge personal pressure, right? I mean, you're on the front lines. A lot of these guys we talk to, I mean, they're career cops. They want to keep the city safe, and they will do whatever they're told will keep the city safe. Now, just from a pure logical argument standpoint, you know, if January 1st, 2002, they said, you know, every time you cross the street in New York City, you have to hop on your right foot, and that'll help stop terrorism, and then we weren't attacked again, that doesn't mean that hopping on one foot stops terrorism. I mean, that just doesn't – that's not how you do sort of methodological analysis, as I screw that up. So that was one of our that was a red flag for us, is if that's how we do this. But every morning, Dave Cohen has a meeting before he meets with Ray Kelly, and he talks to all of his senior guys, and he says, what do we got going on today? And some days they say, we're getting, you know, nothing. Same thing as yesterday, running those traps, and we're out here, we're doing this. And he says, well, what do you mean we got nothing? I got to go and brief the commissioner. What do you got, nothing? And he's, I got 300 guys out there. You give me nothing? So then, of course, it rolls downhill, right? I mean, you're exactly right. There's pressure. And so a lot of these guys who are, you know, involved in this, who were, you know, making notations like, I observed two Korans in my visit. I mean, not because they were like, oh, God, two Korans must mean a threat, but because they were like, if you don't report it, it was so clear that if you're the last guy to visit a location and then somebody from that location blows himself up, they're going to be like, you missed it. So they're like, no, I didn't miss it. I wrote down everything. I wrote down he had two Korans. So, I mean, you're right, there is a pressure, but I think as what John alluded to, when you are collecting all of this information, if there's not somebody saying, well, What good does that do for us to say there's two Korans?
Well, that, not only that, but it seemed like even as they were producing this point, these reports, nobody was vetting the information. You know, they would go, I mean, I lived in Brooklyn for 5 years, and I lived next to the Syrian community. And they would go to the restaurants there, and they would go in, and, you know, they'd write things down, and, you know, this is a Syrian restaurant. And the reports say, we're going to look at Syrian Muslims. But the problem...
We're not going to look at Syrian Christians.
We're not going to look at Syrian Christians. But you know, while maybe the original owner was Syrian Muslim, he today is a Syrian Christian. And so when you show him this report, he doesn't know why he's in the report. And he says, but why don't they just come and ask me, and I'll tell them. I'm happy to talk to them. And that was the overwhelming response to people we talked to. They just didn't understand why they're in these files. Well, why don't the police just come and talk to us? Yes, you can look at the falafel we serve. And the other point, too, talking to people who were involved in these programs at the NYPD, you know, some were bragging to us. Others thought it was a complete waste of time. I mean, we're spending an enormous amount of money running around doing these things, and they're not producing anything.
And to be fair, a lot of the people who helped, I mean, there's this perception that the only people who cooperated with our reporting were these sort of naysayers or, you know, people who got passed over for, you know, promotions or whatever. A lot of the people who talked to us were proud of what they did, and they said, you know, this is a program we should be talking about. This is a program we should be, you know, that we should be studying. Let's best practices this. Let's replicate this elsewhere. We shouldn't be ashamed to talk about what we're doing 10 years out. And that's, I think, the discussion we've hoped to get going.
Yeah, and one of the other interesting things, you know, there's the hundreds of millions of dollars that have been spent on this, and the 600 people who work for Dave Cohen, 300 people who work for Dave Cohen, you know, you ask yourself, what if we'd put those resources and those Urdu and Pashto and Dari and Arabic speakers and, you know, because, you know, and Farsi speakers, what if we put them in uniforms and put them out in the communities to walk the beat to gain trust in the neighborhoods? I mean, it doesn't take a genius. The FBI will tell you this. I mean, typically, you know, the Muslim communities are the front line. They are the front line in the war on terrorism. If somebody comes into their neighborhood and they don't recognize that guy and he's odd, you know, whatever the reasoning is, he's going to go, that person will go to the police. But, you know, now the Muslims feel betrayed. And they're less, you know, they themselves have said they're less likely to come forward with tips.
So this is an interesting one, and it feeds back into the PatCon paper. And I swear this will be the last question I ask. I just think this is fascinating. But which is the sort of, and you mentioned it, John, which is this reaction and paranoia around government infiltration and spying, right? Which is closely tied to sort of a patriot ideology, but I think you see that reflected increasingly, and this is something I've learned from you, in some of the anarchist, you know, pseudo-anarchist left today. But you also get that kind of messaging out of the now late Anwar al-Awlaki, who talked quite a bit in his propaganda to American Muslims in an attempt to inspire and recruit folks, you know, saying, well, the government's turning on you, they're going to come for you, these kinds of things. And now you see on jihadist websites, not just instruction manuals for building bombs and those kinds of things, but also instruction manuals for identifying infiltrators, right? And that's interesting, right? There is a reaction in the actual extremist system to these kinds of things. You know, from the lessons that you see from the PatCon investigation, what do you think, John, how are actual radical milieus, you know, where violence may emerge, going to react to the specter of these kinds of programs?
Well, I think, you know, my sense is that what we're really lacking on this is data and really like an organized study of it. So everything I'm going to say is going to be anecdotal and subjective. And what I think we need is really like, you know, and I talk about this at the end of the paper, is an organized study. There is a tremendous amount of anti-government paranoia in the radical but not yet violent communities that every time something like this happens, like this kind of investigation, or, you know, I wrote a piece recently about an army manual that has been interpreted, it was leaked, has guidelines for interning U.S. citizens in it.
Right, yeah.
And, you know, it's been, and these guys are going nuts over it. And, you know, every time you contribute to the validity of their worldview, I think that, you know, is hardens somebody who's on a radicalization path and helps harden them, and doesn't necessarily mean that they're going to act out. And that's, you know, kind of the place where we things really need to be studied more directly. And what I would also say is that what we really haven't studied is how the cumulative impact of all this stuff affects non-radical communities. We haven't really seen an examination of how, for instance, these NYPD revelations or, you know, the pattern of using informants and undercovers very aggressively for prevention is affecting ordinary people, ordinary Muslims or people who are, you know, leaning toward anarchism or people on the left or the right. You know, we don't like as a society to talk about the fact that our mainstream political discourse spills over into radical movements. But, you know, what we have now is that really people within the mainstream political discourse are saying that every terrorism plot is created by the FBI and the CIA because of the involvement of these undercovers. And if you and as with the PatCon case, if you look at each individual case, you know, each one stands up in court. Each one, you see somebody had a report of somebody who's dangerous for the most part. There are a couple of exceptions to this, but, you know, you can see the rationale for taking the actions that were taken in each individual case. But what we don't do is we don't look at the cumulative effect of having an informant or an undercover agent, you know, helping an alleged bomber every single time.
Yeah, don't ever buy C4 from anybody.
Yeah.
But they'll say that. I mean, they'll say, right, like, the more suspicious that you can make people who want to buy C4, the more suspicious you can make them of the guy who's trying to sell them C4, the better we are for it, because maybe they won't buy it from the next guy who could legitimately sell them C4,
well,
right?
And it does. And that paranoia does disrupt people who might act. But the question
is...
Right, I mean,
that's part of the strategy. Yeah.
Right, but the same time is that what you're also doing is the same kind of preventative paranoia. And, you know, I mean, people I talked to who were involved in PatCon said that part of what they were trying to do is to let these guys know they're being watched constantly. And, you know, and part of what that does is it also hardens their hostility. Some people drop off and some people become harder, and we don't really know that much about it. And what we don't know is, like, somebody who's, you know, a pro-gun ownership person or somebody who's a conservative Muslim who sees these stories and sees this pattern of behavior, how does it affect them? And it does make them more prone to feeling alienated, to feeling radicalized, or, you know, or are they indifferent to it? I mean, we don't have answers to those questions because nobody's asking them in a systematic way.
Mm-hmm. All right, let's go to the audience. Questions? Yes, here in the white.
My name is Maria Mariani, and I am involved with a national security education program. It's a critical language program, and I recruit people who speak languages that are critical to our national security. I'm all over the country. I'm in mosques and temples and everything else, and I'm proud to say that our program, we don't violate First Amendment rights. We don't investigate the people who are applying for our scholarships. And our program is funded by the Office of the Director of National Intelligence. And these people apply like everybody else. They're U.S. citizens. And based on their merits, they get the scholarship or don't get the scholarship. And then they're vetted later when they decide to take positions or offered positions by the intelligence community or wherever else they want to work to help our nation's, you know, security. So I'm freaked out by the fact that some people think it's okay to do what the New York City Police Department is doing.
Okay. Yes, Jen, right behind you.
Hi, Russ Deming now at SICE. First of all, congratulations on an excellent series. My question is, has this prompted any greater scrutiny in Washington at the Capitol Hill Executive Branch of NYPD intelligence activities? And if not, why not?
No.
Why not?
Well, I mean, part of it is, I mean, there's not, I mean, all of it is, there's not really a political, there's no political benefit to looking into this, and certainly not into doing anything that could be perceived to hinder the NYPD's ability to keep the city safe. I mean, Pete King, Congressman from Long Island, is the chair of the Homeland Security Committee in the House, and so that seems, you know.
Schumer.
I mean, so, and on the judiciary, and Senate judiciary, Chuck Schumer is a huge supporter of the NYPD. You know, 36 members of Congress have written to the Justice Department and said, hey, you know, you open these investigations into police departments that violate civil rights. We'd really like it if you could look into what the NYPD is doing and just tell us whether this violates people's rights. That was 9 months ago, and the Justice Department is reviewing the letter to request a review. Tom Perez, the Assistant Attorney General for Civil Rights, literally runs away from me when I show up to events to ask him, like, hey, does the Justice Department also consider American black Muslims to be an ethnicity of interest?
I was going to say, Bloomberg's response has been somewhat flippant, and Ray Kelly's response has been, well, 3,000 dead, never again. You know, I lived in Israel for 3 years during the worst terrorist bombings, 95 to 98. And living in Israel didn't preclude the Israelis from asking their government whether their policies worked, because there was a Holocaust and the state was created so it never happened again. And, you know, nobody, it seemed like a great part of that during the series is like people weren't willing to challenge that because 3,000 people had died.
And at the White House level, I mean, John Brennan gave a speech pretty recently in New York and said, I have the utmost confidence that everything the NYPD is doing is legal and is keeping the city safe. And then when that got reported, the White House sent out an anonymous statement saying, well, you know, he wasn't talking about the surveillance. We don't take a position on that. So getting them to sort of say whether they support the programs that they're funding is tricky.
And if they're not going to take a legitimate look at this, then how does the Muslim community react to it?
Right,
they're very upset in New Jersey.
Well, and it's interesting too because I mean there is no Muslim community in New York City.
It's fragmented
because there's, you know, the Bangladeshi community does not interact regularly with the Egyptian community, which does not interact regularly with the Pakistani community. It's sort of like saying the Catholic community in New York City. I mean, it just doesn't work that way. Also, the civil rights organizations, the Muslim civil rights organizations, typically in the United States, tend to be newer, you know, sort of cropped up post 9/11. They don't have the sort of the experience. They certainly don't have, in a lot of instances, the political clout to make waves about this. What was interesting is when we started writing about what was going, that they were doing this in Newark and in places in New Jersey, where you see a much, frankly, first of all, the Muslim communities tend to be more affluent in New Jersey. Second of all, they also, in many neighborhoods, are African-American black converts, you know, sort of black Muslim converts. And the civil rights organizations, the African-American civil rights organizations, are much more mature, much more politically savvy, much more well-established. And you saw that just took hold much quicker and got political responses much quicker from Cory Booker, you know, Governor Christie, in a way that just hasn't happened in New York.
John, what's your perception when we look at these kinds of, because there is, I think there has been a perception that these kinds of techniques, not, I mean, obviously NYPD is sort of is a unique case, but within the country at large, there's been a lot of talk about FBI surveillance and infiltration techniques related to, you know, Al-Qaeda style terrorism of American Muslims. But I think only recently has that conversation really sort of spilled out into other groups, at least hit the mainstream in recent years, with talk about some of the anarchist plots in the Midwest and these sorts of things. Does it matter in the way that we talk about this, depending on the ideology of the group, right? I mean, there was this article in Rolling Stone a couple days ago that I sent to you guys, and with basically the assertion that federal law enforcement makes a big deal about it if it's, you know, would-be jihadis, would-be lefty anarchists, doesn't talk about this when it's a right-wing white nationalist type. But at the same time, that article acknowledged that this is actually happening more often among right-wing white nationalist types. What's the conversation? What are we missing here?
Well, There are nuances in how this plays out. I mean, we are seeing an increase of these kinds of tactics. We saw just recently arrests of people on the fringes of the Occupy movement. We've seen arrests of right-wingers, using the same kind of sting tactics that are being used in Muslim cases. What I would argue, and I don't think people talk about it very much, is really, if there's a difference in how Muslims are treated in this process, it has to do with firearms ownership and mere possession of dangerous explosives or an interest in explosives. Because in the Patriot kind of sphere, these guys are heavily armed. If you have a Muslim in New York City with, 20 guns, including semi-automatics, in his apartment, that's going to be handled differently than a guy in rural Tennessee who has the same setup. And so I think certainly that they handle some of these cases differently, and especially because of this intense focus on the idea of lone wolf terrorism. I'm not sure that it's. I think we need to really examine it and try and figure out how productive it is. I mean, I tend to. For the most part, I think that when you look at these cases at the federal level, they're pretty by the book about it. They have a playbook that you go through this. The guy gets six opportunities to remove himself from the plot. They're finding people who are really kind of committed to do this. I think in most of these cases, you're not seeing people being provoked into doing something. Mm-hmm. But you see some cases in the Muslim community which are more borderline. Mm-hmm. And I don't think you would see that in the white supremacist community. I don't think they would like string somebody along and encourage them and hand them a fake bomb. I mean, they wouldn't need a fake bomb. That's part of the problem, is that those guys already know how to make a bomb.
Interesting. Yeah. Jen, over here in the white shirt.
Thanks. Thanks for the panel. Have you guys sort of figured out an affirmative, small p, progressive policy to do, to integrate, state and local in counterterrorism? Because, I mean, it's most of what you've done is, a critique, an intellectually honest critique, but a critique. But do you have an affirmative policy of how to do this?
I mean, just for as far as me and Adam and I go, I mean, we didn't set out here to say the NYPD is doing this wrong and it should be done differently. I mean, we set out to say, what is the NYPD doing, and why won't anybody talk about it? And so I'm not convinced, as I sit here today, that what the NYPD is doing is not the best way to do. I mean, everybody says they're the gold standard. And so I think when we looked at this, we just said, well, if they're the gold standard, then let's figure out what it is they're doing.
But their reaction, which baffled us, because when we originally reported a story, the first big story on this in August 2011, when we described everything you've heard, we didn't have the documents yet. They lied. And they said it's fiction.
These programs don't exist. There's no such thing as a demographic thing.
And it's interesting, people step forward and they said, well, why would you lie about a program I'm working in?
Why would you lie about a successful program?
Why would you lie about a successful program? And then, then we reported then we got a hold of the documents that showed that put proof to the pudding.
I will punt this question deftly and say, it's not our job, to say, America's counterterrorism policy should look like this. I mean, our job, I think, is here's what America's counterterrorism policy does look like. And it's for everybody in the room and everybody who votes and everybody whoever decide whether they want our counterterrorism policy to look like this. God forbid, but that journalists should have to write laws.
Or policy.
Terrible. But, I mean, the Obama administration has they've been very upfront about they are going to change the way America is viewed in the Muslim world, and they hit the reset button with the Muslim world, and they have this vision for what they want police departments to be in fighting terrorism. Now, it's very hard to get them to say exactly what that is, but when we say, is it this? Is it the NYPD that's what you want everybody to be? They won't answer it. And that struck us as just very odd because, frankly, to the vast majority of the world, New York is America, right? I mean, so whatever's happening in New York to people's relatives, to, you know, that's the way, you know, if you're sitting at a cafe in Amman and you get an email from your brother in Manhattan and this is going on in New York, it might as well be going on all across the United States because New York is America. So the fact that we can't get a straight answer about where anybody stands on this in New York only makes us made us even more interested in diving deeper and trying to explain what was going on there. So short answer, no, I don't have a better policy. But I'm also not trying to say this policy isn't the right one. I'm just saying we should have an honest conversation about it.
I'll make a policy comment of sorts. What we've done since September 11th, our policy on counterterrorism has been more. And we've got a structure, which is our justice system, from the local all the way up to the federal level. And it's a Christmas tree, and we just keep hanging ornaments on it. And now you can't even see the tree anymore. And one of the most difficult things for politicians and policymakers to do is to say, we're going to do less. But somebody's got to say it because, you know, and David Gartenstein Ross has written about this. You know, we have a system that is increasingly bloated, increasingly expensive, and increasingly intrusive. And we don't have any mechanism in our political or policy discourse to say how we're going to scale this back. Instead, we just get, you know, brand new and improved body scanners and we get, you know, larger kind of demographic mining, and we get more and more and more and more. And you know, that's not a policy formulation that leads to success.
And it shouldn't be off limits to say what do we want to do and what's really working. I mean, the sort of the Christmas tree analogy is a good one. I hadn't heard that one. There's, you know, Adam and I have talked about this sort of this mantra, spoken and unspoken, that the United States is going to take all legal means to prevent terrorism, and we're going to do everything we can within the power of law. That's just not true. I mean, we just will not do that, right? I mean, so, you know, we always sort of use this as an example for when people say, well, are these programs legal? Yeah, maybe. I don't know. That's not my – I'm not a lawyer. I'm not a judge. But we don't take all legal means to prevent terrorism. You know why? Because you can still bring a bag – for now, onto a plane. If we really wanted to say nobody's allowed to bring bags onto planes, that would be legal and that would help prevent terrorism, right? You couldn't get anything onto a plane. We don't do that. Why don't we do that? Because we made a cost-benefit analysis. And that, I mean, I think that's the kind of, those are the kinds of discussions we hope these stories talk about. Well, what are the cost benefits of all of our policies? Because a lot of these programs have never been studied. Like you said, there's never been a study. We don't know if they work or if they're successful or what you're giving up in exchange if this is working for some safety.
And also, I mean, you know, the reason that we still are allowed to take bags on is because we haven't gotten to it yet. The thing is that, you know, especially if you look at, it's certainly TSA is kind of the poster child for this thing, and it's a little bit different from what we're talking about here. But, you know, but TSA provides an example. It's like, you know, they will continue to add layers and they will never subtract them. You may recall about a year ago that there were stories saying that we were going to be allowed to carry liquids on planes and we were going to be allowed to keep our shoes on going through gates. Well, I did not notice that I was allowed to do either of those things when I flew here for this event. So, you know, they're...
I take my shoes off and I got swabbed. So now it's you're getting swabbed too.
Like, so I mean, they'll keep adding. There's a mechanism to add things. We're predisposed politically to add things, and whether it's a surveillance program, or whether it's a kind of wiretapping. You know, I mean, wiretapping is a whole other area of this that we haven't even talked about. You know, the predisposition is to just keep hanging ornaments on the tree, and we've got to start taking some off that don't work and aren't efficient and are counterproductive in other ways, and we don't have any political will to have that conversation.
I barely have the will not to ask questions. Jen, will you ask Alejandro up here on the front?
Thanks to New America and our panelists for this very interesting discussion today. My name is Alejandro Vitel, and I'm with the Muslim Public Affairs Council. And again, thank you all for your remarks. I kind of want to piggyback off of a question that Brian had asked before, so giving you some satisfaction there. But basically, what you had asked before was how do we frame a program that works that isn't necessarily the NYPD? And so I want to, it's a comment and a question. And my comment is that in recent days, our organization with a coalition of other community and civil rights organizations have been sitting down and having discussions, for instance, with the LAPD to come up with ways, for instance, on a specific issue such as the suspicious activity reporting to improve the way that the intelligence collection is being done while at the same time trying to come to some sort of modicum of understanding of preservation of civil liberties. But even so, I guess I still want to pose the question to everyone there, especially even to you, John, going back to one of your articles that you had written, Foreign Policy Magazine, which is how can Muslims contribute, American Muslims contribute to the framing of a more effective program, and not just in the policy discourse, but even at the popular level too? Where can we begin to have a serious conversation? What are the contours, and where can we see some of this going?
Well, I'll address that briefly because that's one of the things that was talked about when we interviewed Muslims. And after our series, it became clear to them that they felt they didn't have a voice. And nobody was willing to stand up for them in New York City because of what happened on 9/11. They didn't have any political clout because the communities are fragmented and they don't vote as a bloc. And I'm certainly not suggesting this, but one of the conclusions that they had come to is that we have to have a grassroots movement. We have to come together and we have to give ourselves a voice to be heard. Because let's just be frank, if you don't have political clout, nobody's going to listen to you, whether it's city council or Capitol Hill. It's as if you don't exist.
You know, a lot of the problem, again, you know, comes out of our political setup. And I know the article you're referring to, points out that, you know, politically on the right side, people on the right tend to approach Muslims as if they are a hostile enemy to a greater or lesser extent. People on the left side tend to treat them as children and to be oversensitive to their feelings while at the same time wanting to change them in some vaguely undefinable way. And, you know, I guess if I was to offer advice, I would say that, you know, with the exception of an organization of the magnitude of the NYPD and with what they're doing, but I would say that the further you take the conversation out of Washington and engage people in more local kind of venues, probably the better off you are. And then you sort of like do a ground up reframing of this. Because I think that when you get out of Washington and you're talking to more ordinary people, you know, even if they're in government at the, you know, government and politics, there's less posturing. Because I think a lot of this, what I just said about the right and the left, I think a lot of it is posturing. It's very self-conscious posturing when you're in the media spotlight. And I think, you know, when you're talking to a mayor and you're talking to a police chief, you know, it's different. It's more human.
I'll sort of to echo both those points with a fun anecdote that I think sums up what we were talking about, sort of the political maturation of the sort of Muslim advocacy groups, along with the fractured nature that Adam was talking about. So I don't know, we're a few stories into our series, and the Justice Department had a legal forum for. It was on Muslim civil rights, but the idea was supposed to, it was mostly hate crime. Like, it was supposed to be like, you know, anti-Muslim bias crime. And so you had all these, you know, top guys from the Department of Justice were there and, you know, representatives of the, you know, Muslim community, capital M, capital C. And so we went and we, you know, because a lot of the people who we knew were going to be on the panel had expressed a great deal of frustration and were very upset about what they were reading in our stories about the NYPD. And they wanted to know what the Justice Department thought about that. It barely got a mention. One person brought it up, not as a question, just sort of said, I am troubled by this, and sort of moved on. And when we talked to people afterwards, they said, well, you know, we were asked, you know, look, if we could just really keep this on the sort of Muslim, you know, what the Justice Department's doing to help us with the whole Muslim, you know, bias, hate crime stuff, and not to get into the whole NYPD thing. So, you know, it was their thing. We didn't want to go off script. And that's fine. I mean, that's, you know, it was telling to us because if leaders of the, you know, civil rights leaders in the African-American community had felt outraged by a policy and wanted answers from the Justice Department, it was hard for me to imagine a bunch of African-American civil rights leaders sitting on stage with the Justice Department and not having somebody say something.
Well,
I think that speaks to a maturation and experience, a political savvy that group has that, you know, the sort of Muslim groups don't have. And the other thing is, I think the NAACP, for the most part, doesn't have to worry that if somebody speaks up at a conference and says, hey, this is wrong and I disagree with this and I want to know what you're going to do about it, that they're going to like be under suspicion, like maybe I'm a terrorist now. So, you know, I think that speaks to a lot of where the Muslim community, you know, which I throw that around in quotes because I'm not sure that word really means a lot, where they are on this. I just think,
Other questions? Let's go here.
Hi, I'm Margot Williams with NPR. And I'm curious about the peculiarity of New York City as being the place beyond it being a 9/11 thing. I'm from Queens, and I recall that there's a whole history of this kind of unit being New York City police department in the 50s and 60s. There was the Red Squad that the New York, the NYPD was very proud of, that their role was surveillance, infiltration, you know, all of these same kind of
things.
But I mean, it just seems like this is a quite a long history. In fact, there's a map that exists back in the teens and 20s that describes the city and all the neighborhoods in it by what political point of view people had. Do you think that the NYPD, it's a tradition among them to see themselves as their own type of intelligence department?
No, I mean, I think the 50s and 60s, the Red Squads was unique, and I don't think they were, I think it was a unique time, and I don't think, frankly, that was a unique operation in the 50s and 60s. I don't think the NYPD was the only one out with Red Squads and monitoring dissident behavior. And the map you're referring to wasn't actually an NYPD thing. It was a City of New York thing. I don't think the NYPD, has traditionally been in the business of doing what it's doing. And to that regard, I mean, you have to give it a ton of credit for, you know, taking a hard turn after 9/11 and developing this really, really quickly. But I mean, to the extent, I don't think this is sort of in their DNA. I think this is a response to stimulus, as they would say. I mean, this 9/11 happened, and this has been their response.
Hey, you turned a bunch of cops and the intel officers with no training.
What does it mean when we ask local PDs to be intelligence agencies, right? I mean, this is something new that isn't just in New York, but we've asked local PDs to plug into domestic intelligence operations that the FBI is doing because we feel the need to prevent incidents.
Yeah.
Are there specific lessons from this broader incident with NYPD? And John, if you've got thoughts on this too, for how we structure that, because this is clearly something, this isn't going away, right? Whether or not the NYPD program stays the way it is or whether it evolves over time, local police departments are going to be doing more intelligence gathering and trying to understand the world around them so that they can anticipate, right? Where do you see that trend going?
I mean, for starters, so post 9/11 created, you know, one of my favorite 9/11 buzzwords, outreach, right? The FBI doesn't have a outreach program for the Irish community, right? They don't have an outreach program for the Catholic community, right? I mean, why do they have an outreach program for the Muslim community? We know why they have an outreach program in the Muslim community, and they should, right? I mean, you know, one of the things is, you know, the FBI is like, we didn't know anybody in the community. We didn't have any contacts. But it was outreach in a sort of blurry kind of, we also kind of want to know what's going on over in that community. And so that line of like, we're here to help, which in many cases they are here to, I mean, in most cases, I mean, they are here to help. That line between we're here to help and also just to get a look around, right? I mean, that's kind of, we don't really know, I don't think we as a country totally know how we want to do that. And we shouldn't know yet. I mean, we're figuring it out. I mean, this, you know, a lot of this stuff is, a lot of this stuff is new and it's complicated. And I don't know that, you know, this, you know, the, as part of this, you know, we figured out that the CIA has trained guys from the NYPD at the spy school, at the farm, the CIA's, you know, spy school, and then sort of sent them back out into New York to be intelligence officers. I don't know if that's the right model. I mean, do we want guys at the NYPD treating, you know, their city like the CIA treats Beirut?
Well, I think the CIA has made a conscious decision. There was an IG investigation after our story, and the CIA's IG, David Buckley, reported that that there was little supervision going on with the officer, Larry Sanchez, who was there. And then this other senior, he's actually a clandestine operative. He was the COS chief of station in Amman in Pakistan. He ran the CIA's counter-proliferation division. This is one of the most senior clandestine officers in the agency. And he was put over there more than a year ago to be special assistant to Dave Cohen. And, you know, we asked the question, well, why do they need that guy there? Like, he was running operations in Pakistan and Jordan and counterproliferation. Why do they need him there? And we kept asking that question. We kept asking that question, and nobody could answer us. Nobody could answer us. And then finally, Petraeus pulled him home. We're not going to answer the question. He's not going to be there. And you know, what Petraeus has said publicly, I'm not going to quote this accurately 100%, but he did say, we're going to have a relationship with NYPD, but that's not going to be the relationship.
And I don't know. I mean, I don't know that we know what we want from our police department. And I think that's a big part of what this story is about. We don't know what we want, and I don't think we know what, as a country, we don't know exactly what we want from the FBI either. And you know, I don't know. And I think you're right that we'll want a lot more if there's another attack, right? I mean,
we want them to keep things from blowing up. I mean,
yeah, but the problem with that,
but we're
problem
not
with that
to
model,
not take bags onto planes, right? So I mean, there is some limit that we say we don't want them to go this far, but where do we? How far do we want them to go? Yeah.
But the problem is here. I mean, in this conversation, is conflating outreach to the Muslim community in terms of trying to understand the Muslim community and preventing terrorism, yeah. And where you see that fail completely is when you look at the CVE policy that the White House put out. And it's all about the outreach. It's all about reaching out to the Muslim community and doing, apprising them of their constitutional rights. It's not CVE, because if you're doing that, you can't apply it to white supremacists. There is no outreach to the white community. There is no outreach to, you know, let whites know that they have rights that should be protected. And there never will be. And as long as you're conflating sort of this social, let's meet the neighbors approach to, hey, let's put the neighbors in jail.
You're almost segregating them.
Right? Yeah, and
it's a great point. And the White House model is built off of the gang model, right? So we want our school teachers to look for the signs of gang activity. You're wearing colors, you're truant, you're smoking pot in the parking lot, you're running with a bad crew, you're maybe, you know, breaking into homes. So now we want teachers to look for early signs of radicalization, and we want to raise a red flag, early warning signs. The problem is that, like, a lot of the early warning signs for gang activity are illegal. A lot of the early warning signs for being, you know, radical are not illegal. And I don't know there's any teacher in this country. I mean, teachers are fine for, like, kid, why are you out smoking pot? That's dumb. Don't do that. I don't know there's any teacher in this country in a public school who's like, why are you reading your holy book that way? I think you should read it this way. Don't interpret that to mean that. You should read it. The idea that we can just take the gang model and just drop it over here, you know, like John said, and that's CVE for us. I mean, it's way more complicated than I think public discourse is allowing it to be.
Yeah. Jen, let's take two final questions. We're here in the green shirt, and then Aki, did you have a
No, you're good. Okay, in the green shirt, this will be our last question because we're out of time. We could go on forever. You guys are interesting.
Hi, thank you for the discussion. My name is Barry Jones. In your investigations, did you find maybe unvoiced minority who was focused on the motivation for violence rather than outreach or whatever else these investigations seem to be focused on? In investigating the stories that you have reported, did you find a faction of people in law enforcement who were focused on the motivation that brings people to these extreme acts? Like, one thing I've never forgotten was in the earliest reports that about Osama bin Laden after 9/11 was that his intention was not to fight the U.S. militarily. He wanted to draw us into unpopular wars in lands as far away from America as possible in order to bankrupt us. So I remember that, but I don't see that being discussed today as we fight terrorism.
The NYPD was really, I mean, I'll say it, they were at the cutting edge because they were doing it publicly before anybody else was doing it in terms of trying to study radicalization in the West and why were people getting radicalized. I think a lot of people look back on that original radicalization in the West study and say, well, I see some problems here, you know, or I wouldn't have done it that way. But at the time, I mean, you'll correct me if I'm wrong, you know this better than I do. At the time, I mean, they were the only ones, and they put themselves out there and said, hey, let's try to look at what these red flags are. And they did try to do that. And sort of one of the authors of that, Mitch Silber, is kind of the dean of analysis at the NYPD. And he's, you know, he's taking... you know, he's taken analysis of the NYPD, you know, and take it into a whole new direction. And I think, I'm not speaking for me to speak for Mitch, but I mean, I think Mitch would tell you that there was an evolutionary process at the NYPD in terms of their understanding of the threat and the roots of radicalization as well. And I think that, you know, that's as much of a reflection of analysis in this. But, I mean, they were doing that. They for sure were doing what you're talking about.
If you look at the people who came from New York, like Zazi and Zerain and Madunjanin and Venice, they were all typically upset by what was happening in Abu Ghraib or Afghanistan or Iraq, and they wanted to go over there and actually fight against U.S. soldiers abroad, but it was only once al-Qaeda got their hands on them that they sort of got them to come back around. It'll be interesting going forward. You know, look, we're out of Iraq. I mean, apparently now we're drawing down from Afghanistan, not in 2014, I think it's 2013. It'll be interesting going forward what that does to this whole radicalization model. Mm-hmm. So,
yeah.
You know, in my book on American jihadists, Jihad Joe, which is on sale everywhere, I looked at, hundreds of case studies of why specifically homegrown radicals become violent. And what I found was that there are not real clear trends. There are a lot of different things that factor into it, and you can sort of point to some generalities, but ultimately, you know, when you're dealing with terrorism, I mean, there's an inbuilt bias, I think, in government that you don't deal with the grievance, you deal with the violent act. And
the same with murder, by the way. Cops don't focus
on
the
yes,
why.
We have justifiable homicide.
Right.
We do have some leeway in that we don't have in terrorism. But, I think that that's probably generally the right approach, especially when you look at when you actually look at the cases and see how different they are from each other and how everybody has kind of a different trigger point or a different motivation. I think it's good for us to understand those things, though, and to study them. But again, and you know, I'll keep pulling the same rabbit out of my hat. But you know, we don't look to, we don't ask why white supremacists are radicalized and try and change them. Use a government program or a aggressive policy to try and change their views. And in fact, if we did that, it would backfire terribly. There's only so much you can deal with what people think and, you know, and use that as a basis to try and project
Tarek
their
Mahana.
Actions. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, Tarek Mahana, you know, it's a complicated case. I would have liked to have seen a less aggressive prosecution of him, but he lied to the FBI. He went to Yemen in search for terrorist training. by over-prosecuting him, I think that, you know, the district attorney and the U.S. attorney in Boston, I think, gave an opportunity to make that case into something it didn't have to be, to sort of test the bounds of some First Amendment issues that we didn't have to get at, when really they could have put him in jail for 8 years, and I think that would have been adequate. And, you know, so...
We should actually just have an entire another event about Tariq Mahana at some point, because we could go on for an hour.
That might be it on this.
That's right, hour and a half about that as well. Thank you very much to all three of our panelists. Really, that was fascinating. I just really quickly want to put in a plug for an event that we're going to be doing here next Tuesday, Jen. What time is it? The 29th. With the lead author of the Combating Terrorism Center at West Point's report about the Osama bin Laden documents that were released 2 weeks ago. It should be really fascinating. Nellie LaHood is brilliant, and we'll all learn a lot from her. So thanks for coming.